Today I'm speaking to 21-year-old Nilakantha Banu, who won the gold medal for India at the 2020 Mind Sports Olympiad. And he holds a few world records for being the world's fastest human calculator.
The numbers are 79, 7972 and 8734.
I think we first got in contact with each other after I made a video about Shakuntala Devi from India. Yes. And she previously, I think, held this record for, you know, fastest human calculator. And yeah, I'm wondering, have you beaten her record? And if so, what was that record?
Shakuntala Devi was, let's say, one of the first math magicians, if I have to put it this way, who has established math as a performance act, which is that going onto stages, making people clap, making people enjoy the art of, let's say, solving questions in front of them. She held a lot of world records, but there's this one specific world record, which is called the fastest human calculator record, where one gets to add a number to itself as quickly as possible. If it's a two-digit number, if I have to put it this way, one has to do the multiples of it very quickly and say the answers out. So if I start with 28, it goes 28, 56, 84, 112, 140, 168, and so on, so on. So the record is to do as many times in 15 seconds. So these records were once held by her, Mr. Scott Flansburgh from the United States. And that's the record which I've broken a couple of years ago in racing past and doing it for 42 times in 15 seconds.
I've seen some videos of it done, and yeah, I find it really impressive. And in fact, when I first read the story of Shakuntala and then heard your story as well, my initial thoughts are, and maybe these are the thoughts of many people, it's like, wow, that is such a special talent. And those people seem so different to me because, you know, I feel like I could never do that. And I think many people maybe feel the same. I wonder if you could answer, you know, is there something special about you guys who can do this?
I personally do not think that this is a feat or a feature which can be achieved by being gifted or being, let's say, naturally, innately talented. Because of one sheer reason that everyone's born with the same, let's say, mathematical, raw material. It's just about how you train it. And my question again, which I think I'll do more as we go, which is to compare math with being a sport, is that if one wants a ripped body with a tight six pack, is it really possible for everyone? Yes. But it does take the effort, which is to train, to diet, to do a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, so it sounds like you're saying it takes, you know, the willingness and the motivation to want to do this, and also a lot of hard work. I guess training like any classic Olympian for any other sport, I guess. So, you know, I'd be curious to know when you were training for this, what was your sort of daily routine? How did you find the time to do this kind of study?
So, my journey in mental calculation started when I was very young, very, very young. So I actually met with an accident when I was 5, when I was bedridden for an entire year. That has nothing to do with my calculation abilities. But at that point of time, I picked up puzzles and calculations as a way, which is, be it magic squares, be it a bunch of other stuff which we genuinely, let's say, see in our daily routine, right? So, this was the point of time where I sort of picked and started falling in love with what puzzles and math and numbers and stuff are. I fumbled on to, let's say, picking mental calculation as something which I was interested in and started going for regional championships. And I won the regionals, nationals, and the international championships in the span of 3 years. Directly, I was the international champion in speed calculation under the age of 20 years by the time I was 13. That was in Singapore. My routine when I did practice for this was, I used to go to school, come back around 4 p.m. in the evening, and then sort of work on. Because, at the end of the day, I would consider mental math to be a sport, which again gives it a value of entertainment, right? So, for me, it never was that, okay, sit in front of the paper, solve this exam. It was about give this attempt, try doing this better, play better. So it's the kind of satisfaction or the sense of achievement you get when you get your soccer balls swing in the air. And that's pretty much what drove me forward. I used to practice for around 6 to 7 hours a day, consistently for 3 to 4 years. Today, I don't practice as much, but I still make it a point that I'm active for at least one and a half hour every day to sort of look into this and pursue this further, because I think this has answers to a lot of things which human cognition has to scope in and do more in.
Great, yeah. One thing I'd be curious to ask is that, you know, on my channel, I've done a few videos in the past relating to exams, and specifically exams in India, things like the JEE to get into university. And before we were recording, you said that you'd gone on to study maths at university. So clearly, you know, at the same time you were studying for this, you know, mental maths, you were also studying your normal schoolwork, right? And did you ever sit the JEE and have to do exams at the same time? How was that experience balancing them?
I really did well in my JEE. In fact, I've actually scored a 115 on 120 in my JEE in math. So that was, so again, right, I would look at it in two directions, which is mathematical acumen building can happen from any side. It's about, I personally look at this as a mountain. You can climb it from any forte, but the end is mathematical excellence. And there's no way you miss out on things as you climb. So, I mean, for instance, if I am doing a speed calculation and at some point of time, I wanted to do an approximation, there's no way I can do that without knowing the Taylor series. There's no way I can do that without knowing how do I extrapolate and sort of do a bunch of other things. When I'm, let's say, approximating a few calculations, there's a lot of ideologies which go behind it, be it, let's say, conic sections, be it a lot of other stuff, which I think is a part of what we do. Number theory, majorly. So prime factorization, if that's the calculation I'm going for. I learned a lot of formal math through the problems I faced while I scaled on becoming the world's fastest human calculator. So I would say that my journey in math was intertwined.
I really liked a comment that you made a bit before about kind of what you had learned about the human brain and about learning itself through your experiences. And I wonder if you could talk maybe a little bit more about that, because maybe that it kind of gives a usefulness as well to what you're doing. Not that it, you know, needs a usefulness, because I know many sports you do just for the sake of showing what's possible, but it seems like here the mental calculation stuff can kind of reveal a bit more about how we work, how we think.
Noam Chomsky, a very famous linguist, says that you sort of look at the world the way you learn language, which is watching the world through the language glass, which is one of the most revolutionary works between language and cognition. I personally think that language and the way you learn numbers sort of determine how you look at the world in general. And if I have to put it this way, from several researches which have been done by Piaget or a lot of other mathematician philosophers who have worked on this, or mathematical psychologists, it's observed more so now than ever that the way a kid or a student learns the number system, the way they learn the operations of math, the way they learn how naturally one flows from the other, logical argumentation and stuff, sort of determines their cognitive compass, if I have to say this that way. When I say cognitive compass, I'm talking about the working memory, the iterative memory, the long-term memory, the reflex, the ability to partition thought, the ability to parallel think. A lot of things here, which is, and if I have to compare it with, let's say, computers, or let's say how a computer functions, it's about how you develop your RAM, how you develop your GPU, how you develop your processor, or however that goes.
Yeah, I guess on that, and also bringing back the, you know, parallels to sports, why do you think that you are able to beat, for example, Shakuntala's record? And I ask that because, you know, in sports, in some sports, maybe marathon running or something else, you see that over time, people seem to be getting faster. Maybe it's the shoes or the swimsuits they're wearing, or maybe it's the way we train. But do you think in a similar way that people are getting smarter? Is that why records are being broken here?
Sure, I could probably do that, because I mean, I personally, I think my practice majorly has not been through pen and paper solutions. It has been aided by software a lot.
Right.
And I would say that that's something which I think plays a very key role. It's this way, right? I mean, there's two ways to approach, let's say, running or for that same marathon, which is, one is to keep running for that 100 meters expecting growth, or do 10K runs, do runs with weights, do runs with something else, train yourself in 10 different things, so that eventually when you come back to this, you're better. Mental calculation and the art of it is slowly in decline, which is, I mean, when I look forward, when I talk to, let's say, 60-year-old war veterans, 70-year-old war veterans across the globe, or I mean, whenever I go and talk, they're way quicker at what they do than, let's say, people of my age or under, because of the reliance on calculators a lot, which is great. For instance, I mean, no one really wants to calculate cost 46 and a half. We don't really want to do that because there's machines doing it for it. So when I compare it with the sport, this is exactly what I say, and I think I'll probably repeat it here, which establishes the point. Usain Bolt runs for 100 meters, right? The reason he runs for the 100 meters is to make sure and inspire people into say that, okay, see, this is what being fit is. It's not that he does not have a car. So I'll probably end up with that saying that, if you're here, you should probably be using Wolfram Alpha. If you're here, you should be using your MATLABs and Mathematica. If you're not, you're not in the math game. But at the same time, it's extremely important for you to train your brain. And there's no better exercise than counting. And trust me, that's literally what I've put here. Brain exercise is, I personally think that math, if you lose out on calculations to be a way in which you train yourself, you're sort of missing out one part of the jigsaw puzzle.
It's really interesting to hear that perhaps technology has played a role in helping you to break records. I guess I'd love to hear a little bit more about, you know, what you're doing now, your current mission.
Math failure is one of the major reasons why students drop out of school, which is drop out of any other educational trajectory they can have. So I think the problem which I go on, and I probably wish to solve this, to sort of at least make math not the speed breaker for someone's career opportunity, because it shouldn't be that hard. And if you let's say inspire people into saying that, because I think that the problem is twofold. One is that it's the social perception that math is boring, which I think it's existent regardless of the country I'm talking about. Oh, not math, not really, not my thing. You do math, you're a geek. So I'm trying to change that by, let's say, doing performances and stage shows across the globe.
This the competitive side of, you know, human calculation, it will really help some people to get inspired with math. For some people, it won't be quite right, because it might bring that, you know, the sense of pressure and competitiveness that comes along with exams too. It can actually sometimes be detrimental. So I think one approach will not work for everyone. This has clearly worked for you. And yeah, I would like to add a little disclaimer that, you know, I personally studied math at uni as well. And I found that, yeah, you can get by just fine without being good at arithmetic, and it's not really going to hold you back. But it's interesting to hear your story of a case where it's actually really helped propel you forward.
Math phobia is existent. I mean, let's accept it that there is a scare of every math exam which comes your way. The two ways to go about it, one is to, as you said, I mean, I think as you pointed out also, that competitively getting over with is not always the best way to go about it also, because of the fact that if you really want to write a book, you don't really have to be a spell bee champion. It's as simple as that. But both of them have their own beautiful forms. And I believe that moving forward, we have more people who sort of work towards catering such experiences globally, where kids no longer are scared of math, but are accepted. They accept it as, let's say, a part of their life, just as we do with English or any other native language we speak.
Great. Yeah, it's a big mission, but I think it's a good one. Yes. Yeah. One little question I'd like to end with is, do you have maybe a role model or someone that you really look up to, maybe from history or now?
Actually, a lot of mathematicians, but let me restrict to a couple of them. One very, very major inspiration through my life from the beginning, how much ever I understood him or not from the beginning, was Srinivasa Ramanujan from
right.
India.
Yes.
Yeah. And I mean, I would say that my devotion towards his work is I think, it goes a long way because of the fact that okay, one is obviously the cultural, the sort of Indianness and the promotion of what he has done globally, but the sheer nature of, let's say, every time I look up into, let's say, read more, I realize that oh, this is more apt to what I do. So I mean, wherever I was fumbling across a bunch of things, I've somehow always come to a certain paper of his, which I'm like, oh wow, this I think is applicable to what I do. So I would say that he was one of my major inspirations around, let's say, performances and making math a culture or let's say something which people consume in India. I'm thankful for Shakuntala Devi. She was never a formal mathematics person herself. She was never formally trained. But I think the relatability of a mathematician to an average citizen of a country is, I think, something which I think I've learned a lot from.
Great. Well, yeah, I find both of those people also very inspirational. So, yeah.
I mean, nameless to say, the other couple of people include Laplace and Newton. I mean, I've not right. gone there, but yeah, but I've not gone there now. Yeah.
Some of the greats. Yeah. All right. Well, congratulations on all of your success and thanks for sharing your insights.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks. It was nice being here. Yeah.